which is still not there, and we'll see how it goes. Okay, so these are just some a few examples of what we are talking about the motor system. I'm going to give you a few examples soon. And basically, although we're going to touch upon a little bit about the motor system itself, what we really mean is the control of the motor system rather than the motor system itself. So we're not that interested in the motor system, but how we control it. Okay. So obviously the motor system is for movement, and movement is has many functions: finding food, partner, shelters, communication, many things. Obviously not all organisms move, but organisms move even from single cell organisms have capability of movement, and this is obviously extremely important. But it also comes at a price, and the price is that it takes energy to move. There is a limit about how much force you can actually produce and use. So obviously, if you want to produce more force, you need to have larger elements. So it could be, in our case, muscles. In cars, it would be a bigger engine. And you have a bigger engine, you can produce more force, but on the other hand, you have to carry a bigger engine, so you have always a trade-off. There's a limit to the speed, and there are constraints about how you actually design the machine in that sense, which actually have a consideration later on the control. So these are all constraints on the movement itself, but the control itself is a major issue. So the fact that you can move doesn't mean that you do it in an intelligent way, or even without adding intelligent, it's the fact that you want to control the movement in itself is producing level of complexities that are far more complex in a way, and we'll touch upon that as well. Okay, so it is important to notice, and Chaya talked about it last week, that many movements in our body are done automatically. This is done mostly by the what's called the autonomic system. So the sympathetic and the parasympathetic and the enteric system. I don't think you have learned that, right, officially. And in previous years, I was actually giving a lecture about that. But what I think of doing is giving you there is an instruction by the rector that every course will have one unit of self-learning. So I'm thinking of giving you the self-learning. But in any case, you know that many things in our body are happening automatically. The gut, peristaltic, is one example that Chaya mentioned before, and there are basically millions of neurons that are responsible for that, and it's not as simple as you might think. It seems like an automatic thing that might be kind of very simple. It's not that simple. Breathing, blood flow, many movements are done without planning conscious. And there's also other issues, for example, posture, that we're not going to talk about at all, but a lot of your motor system, neural motor system, is responsible for maintaining your body at a certain posture. So if you would cancel that now for me, I would just obviously collapse, right? And there's a lot of muscles just working against each other and in synchrony in order to maintain the way our body stands at any point. So what we did last year, and this is a result of it, or like just a sample of it, and I would like to do it this year as well, is that I gave the student each a task to find two clips, two movies that represent for them what is motor control. Okay, and we done it at the beginning, so kind of before we actually dive into all the thing, and then we compile the list and we put it on the Moodle so everyone can see the, you know, everyone else's choices. So these are two choices that are, one of them is kind of obvious. The others are a little bit less. I'm going to show you. Let me just open the file again. I think that's not the latest version. Okay. That's annoying. Okay, I'll show you two, and then I'll go to YouTube and show you the third. Okay, so this is kind of the obvious one. It's called Humans Are... People Are Awesome. Basically demonstrates kind of capabilities that extreme in many ways. But demonstrates the capability of the system. Not all of them are that kind of. I can feel it rising. Bow to the earth, we could ascend, yeah. I'm realizing. I feel both feet lift off the ground. I can levitate. With every truth I believe, I close my eyes and levitate. Some of them. If you see in a minute one that is the same. Basically, you got the point. This is like I haven't looked at it for a while, so I don't remember all the details. But I'll let you see it later yourself. What I want to contrast it with is the state of the art of robotics today. Okay, and this is more or less, I think, where it is. So this is another example, and this is actually, I find it a very impressive example, but So this is a company called Boston Dynamics, right? I think the other one is running the big one. Okay, so this is pretty impressive. This is a robot, a walking robot. Okay, and as you can see, it's what really impressive about it is its ability to stay stable in many different conditions. This is really new, and like until not recently, this would be kind of a dream. And you've seen many times robots that can do almost anything except walking on a flat floor. This one can go on ice and can go in snow, and this is like on ice, I think. Okay. It's pretty amazing. To some extent, a lot of it you see that is kind of inspired by body plan of animals. So you could kind of add the head, and you would think it's a real dog or something. So it's quite impressive, but there's still a long way to go from here to what we've seen in the first clip. Okay. Not that it's impossible, it's certainly possible, and in some ways it's a pretty, I think, good indication that what we call, in some ways, computational neuroscience is meaningful, because the control of this thing is obviously not done by a neural system, it's done by an artificial system. And it just demonstrates that what you have to solve is a computational problem. You have to kind of compute what should activate at any given time any one of the motors that controls these legs of this thing. And this is a computational problem, except that it's an extremely complex problem. And this is what we're kind of, that's the essence of what we're going to talk about in the next few lectures, how the neural, basically the motor system, the neural motor system, is doing that. How is it using neurons to do that, which is also a different question. And what can we learn from that about robotics is obviously interesting. Okay. The last thing I want to show you is also a clip that I like. That's the guy. So this is not the fastest wrapper in the world. This is a faster one, but it's a pretty good example, I think, mainly because the text is underneath. Okay. So this is 1 minute.
Don't know why I'm built so fly, but I am, no lie. Oh my. Roll by, get a low ride huffy, sitting on the peg, with shoulder close puffy. Cuff rolled up to my calf, clash with the ass, babble, swag like Buffy. Gotta be the one to bite the bullet, I'm a sinner, but I bet I could have been a better man. I wanna be Zan, but I got some better, some medicine instead of meditating, but I get it when I can. I don't wanna wipe it with a gutter with a bottle of malt, like a minute, cause I never got a call, telling me that it's all figured out. I'm sticking down, but I'm looking at the wall. Part of me was hoping to be caught up in the moment, to be open to the good and the god of me, but I got a lobotomy, gonna get that out of me, become a bit of an oddity, with somebody gets offended by the thought of me. Who's he? You gotta be kidding me. Do me like Gabourey Sidibe. If you see me with a chickadee, no diggity, it'll be giggity, giggity, giggity. Gonna send like a letter from above with a gay. I'll say you go gay, baby. Work that crib, work that bib, rip that kid. Screw police, rip that car. I don't want a Jesus piece, but I want a Reese's piece and a Kit Kat bar. I want everybody focusing on getting me the letterman to kick it for the betterment of innocent Americans who never want to settle for the pop. Four knocks in my bedroom rocks, and the beat still knocks when I sort my socks. I'm up with a lovative text from the tip of my head to my torches. Means.
So, okay, so basically the message is, I mean, what I wanted to stress is that, I mean, the other clips here that you're invited to watch later, but speech is also, it's obviously another aspect of the motor system that usually kind of is less thought about. But in some ways, it's not as impressive in terms of like extreme and parkour and stuff like that. But it's extremely complicated, motor skill, and in some ways, that's the next thing I'm going to talk to show you. It demonstrates a lot the ability of humans as opposed to other animals. So usually, so when we're not talking about things like speech, we're talking about a system that has a skeletal system. You have bones designed in a certain way, and on top of that, there is a muscle system that that sits and moves these bones. Oh, that wasn't supposed to happen. Okay. Okay. And on top of that, there's a neural system that controls the whole thing, and the neural system is hierarchical. So we have one of the key things to realize is that we have hierarchy, which means that the muscles are here, okay, and then there are different levels of controls that control either directly the muscles or controlling the controller. Okay, so if you take the periphery, the muscles on the body, they are controlled by the spinal cord. The muscles on the face are directly controlled by the brainstem, but the spinal cord itself, the motor part of the spinal cord, is controlled from the brainstem, and the brainstem is controlled from the cortex. Okay. In addition, there are different. There are at least two other main systems that are having a loop with the cortex, and one of them is the basal ganglia, which has a loop from the motor cortex to the basal ganglia, to the thalamus, and back to the motor cortex, back to the cortex. Let's say, and we'll have a lecture by Chagai Bergman about this system later on. And then there is also another system, which is the cerebellar system, which is, I write here the cerebellum, although there is it's not just the cerebellum, there is a cerebellar structure you can think of, that receives input from the cortex and loops back through the thalamus, but it also, there's actually a missing error here. It also receives input from the spinal cord and directly talks back to the brainstem and to the spinal cord. So there are kind of different levels of interactions here. And in addition, in primates, there's also a direct connection from the cortex to the spinal cord, kind of going through the brainstem but bypassing it. So like in mice, the input from the cortex would go to the brainstem and then would go to the spinal cord, like, you know, in two steps. In primates, it actually go directly to the spinal cord. And this is part of why primates can actually have much better control, for example, on their limbs and on their fingers, and in general on their movement. To some extent, they can do much more complex movement. This is also true, again, for speech, where humans are the only animals, only mammals that we know of that have direct connection from the primary cortex to what kind of correspond as the spinal cord of the speech mechanism. So we'll talk about control of muscles, but basically muscles are directly controlled by motor neurons. We'll talk about it in the spinal cord. None of these systems have direct action on muscles. They only go to motor neurons of the spinal cord or to other motor neurons. But primary motor cortex don't have control specifically on muscles. Okay, they have to go through a different level. And, you know, any of you that have any kind of idea about robotics, any has any? What? Michael, I guess, but anyone else? Okay, done. So you know that basically when you would write a program to do this dog, okay, you don't want really... The person who writes the algorithm of what to do when something happens doesn't want to know the details too much of the specific motor that sits in the arm and moves the hand. As always in robotics and in computer science in general, we tend to do these kind of hierarchies. It's just like when you plot something on the screen, you don't really want to care about which screen you're going to put there and what type of LED and how much current it needs in order to become blue or red or green, right? What you need is like you want to say, you know, make blue there and someone will take care of that, right? So this is kind of what we usually call drivers, right? You have like something that do the translation between some higher concept to a lower level architecture. This is, in a way, when you think about it, is the reverse of what we've seen in the sensory systems, right? In some ways, you want to think of a line in space, and you don't care about exactly what type of light made it and how. You're trying to build abstract concepts, okay, of sound. Ellie probably talked to you about that, like sound objects, right? Or words, right? You don't really care about the details of the sound wave. You want to at some point, you're thinking about the concept of the word rather than the specific detail. So this is a reverse picture. You want to think of a movement. I want to move my hand there, right? This is what the cortex is supposed to be, or at least kind of, you know, higher order cortex that are responsible for motor action. That's what they're supposed to be dealing with. And they don't want the details of, you know, which muscle I need to move and exactly, you know, how big is this muscle and how much force it generates and stuff. So these are kind of translated somewhere along this hierarchy. So it's like you're starting in a... That's the way we think about it, right? We're starting with a kind of an abstract concept of movement, and we then kind of translate it slowly, or not so slowly, into the details. But when you do that, then you kind of also lose something in the way, right? Because there's more processing steps, and it can take longer, and it could be kind of becomes quite complicated. It becomes quite complicated in the sense that you lose control on the specific thing. So this is why you have like this shortcut sometimes, okay, in the middle. And So when you think about the brain, this is what it looks like. So in the spinal cord, and we're going to talk about it in more detail. In the spinal cord, there's an area where the motor neuron sits, and they send the axons to the muscle. Okay, these motor neurons and other neurons in this area receives input from the brainstem. In humans, they also receive input directly from the cortex. The cortex interacts with the basal ganglia and with the cerebellum, and the cerebellum is interacting with the brainstem and with the spinal cord, but also with the cortex. And if Ad, that will talk to you about the motor cortex, will talk to you about also about a lot about the fact that in primates, the cerebellum part. So in rodents, for example, most of the cerebellum is interacting with the spinal cord and with the brainstem, but in primates and humans, most of the cerebellum is actually interacting with the cortex. So in some ways, there was some change, major change, during evolution, and this is partially because the cortex now directly controls the motor neurons. So it has this bypass, and if it needs the cerebellum, if this will do something and this will do something through here, this won't work very well. So it kind of the loop with the cerebellum is partially responsible for that. Okay. So one example of these conceptual abstraction that I talked about, you can see here in handwriting. Okay, so the example here is a sentence that is written in you know, using the right hand, which is the dominant hand of the person who wrote it, and then with the same hand, but when the wrist is immobilized, okay, so you don't let the hand move like that, or with the other hand, with the left hand, or with the mouse, or with the foot. And obviously they've been scaled, because this would be like way larger than this thing. Okay? But the idea is that you have an abstract representation of the movement or the outcome of the movement that you want to do, and you can translate it into completely different set of muscles and skeletal system, right? I mean, when you move the foot or when you move the mouth, it's a completely different system. And still you know what you want to write, and you translate it into this different program. So there is some abstraction in the way, and what actually is surprising to some extent here is that you might be even able to identify the person who wrote it, even if he writes it with a mouse, right? Because like there is a similarity in the handwriting in the writing, even when you don't do it with the same hand. So this is another example. Okay, I also want to stress that. Handwriting like that is an extremely complicated process when you think about it, okay? Because when you imagine that you have to trace a letter, okay, or you have to copy it, okay, it's a different thing of like if you're tracing something like that. I mean, you put your pen on that and you just kind of follow the black line. It's a completely different process than looking at that and then copying it to a different place, right? Just imagine, you know, this looks almost exactly the same thing, right? But in fact, this has to kind of represent. This is just a feedback loop. You can easily kind of program something, you know, a computer that just has a camera and just kind of take a picture of your pen and the thing and just follow it, right? This is like if you've seen the cars that has like a sensor, and you can draw something on the floor, and they will run over the line that you done. And this is like a really small chip. But this thing, you have to kind of memorize this somehow, so this visual representation, and then translate it into a motor action. It's a completely different skill. It's much more complicated. And often, you know, we if you watch like children's handwriting books, this is the kind of they'll tell them like, do that three times and then do that, which is like, it looks like, you know, an obvious step. It's extremely different thing and it's very, very complicated. Okay. Now when you go into the details, so this is all very abstract, but now when you go into the details of the specific motor systems that we have to deal with, there are really many, many, you know, details and complications. For example, the muscles that span more than one joint. So you could think of, like, I have a joint, I have muscles, and these muscles are controlling the joint. This is simple. But sometimes you have muscles that are spanning more than one joint, and you have to take care of that. There are many cases, and I'll show you some examples, where the same muscle can actually be doing different things in different movements. Okay, so it's not like one-to-one thing. So here is an example of that. And this is usually, we do a demonstration of that, but for the sake of time, I'll skip it. Imagine that you have to kind of, you have to stand like that, and someone kind of going to drop a book, and you have to catch it, or a ball. So what you see here is like the two joints that are involved, this one and that one, right? And you see the muscles that are controlling these joints. So there are basically four muscles here that we are talking about, and this is what's called an EMG. So an EMG is when you stick an electrode into the muscle, and you actually record the electrical activity in the muscle. And what you see is like the following. First of all, what happens is that the two joints are actually flat before the drop. Okay, so this is where the drop happens. Okay, so they are flat, they don't move. Okay, but there is activity in the muscle. And in a second we'll talk about what kind of activity it is. Okay, then then something happens that you can't actually avoid in this thing. It's like when something you drop, you'll always like have the hand will move, and then will come back to. I mean, if that's what you're trying to do, you're trying to kind of catch it. It will move and then you'll kind of rebound. Okay, so this is what you see here. And you see basically the movement of one joint and the movement of the other joint, and the elbow and the wrist, okay, here. But what's interesting is to see here is that the muscles here are co-activated. So before the movement happens, the muscles act at the same time. So you know about agonist and antagonist muscles, right? So the agonist and the antagonist muscles work at the same time. Okay, so this contract, right? But when the movement starts and you have this movement of the wrist and the elbow, you see that they are starting to work against, not in the same time. So they have like kind of they have this oscillation, and they start to move like against each other. So the reason here is that at the beginning, what you're trying to do is get the joint as stiff as possible. And to do that, in order to make the joint stiff, you activate at the same time the agonist and the antagonist. Okay, and this kind of prevents the wrist from moving. But then when the wrist moves, then one of them has to kind of relax and the other one to contract in order to bring the wrist back to the same position. So basically, the key point is that every movement is an orchestrated activity of many muscles. A lot of that is done subconsciously, as we mentioned. And this is less important. Okay. So another aspect of all this system is that you have trade-off. For example, if you want to be precise at a movement, you have to give up speed. It's really difficult to do both, you know, to do, and you all know that if you want to do a movement very fast and very accurate, it's very difficult, and you have trade-off here. I'm not going to go into all the details of that, but this is kind of obvious. Another thing that is important is this is actually a major issue here, especially computational, is the degrees of freedom, and this is I don't know, maybe this is the problem. So the idea is that if I want to reach this this cup, I can do that like in probably almost infinite number of ways. Okay, even if I do it just with one hand, right? I can move from here, I can move from here, I can move from here. I can do many, many different trajectories that will end up with the same result. Okay, so one of the key issues is how do you select? You know, all these movements will bring you to the same end result. How do you decide which one to do? Question? Okay, that's a good point. What do you mean?
Shortest and lowest energy action.
Okay.
I mean, you would not take it like this. You don't have to. You have a reason in order to do something that consumes more energy.
Okay. That's a good point, but let's discuss it further. There are a few issues here, right? One is, first of all, how do you know? Right? So this is also something that you have to know in advance. You have to compute in a way, right? What would be the lowest energy? Second, it could be that that these things don't go together. Okay, it's actually the case where. Before I say that, there's like one more point that you haven't mentioned that I want you to think of. What do you think? Okay, let's think about what things could we optimize in that sense. So we have many ways to do a movement, and we select, say, the optimal way. This is like what we always say, right? We always do things optimally, except we don't. But okay, and then what is the optimum? In what sense? What kind of optimum can you think of? So energy is one, force is the second, which are probably somehow related, right?
Speed.
Time, speed, accuracy.
The high number of freedom that will make a very hard problem, not linear, and very hard to achieve. So the best is high degrees of freedom, but then it's complex. It takes a lot of power and energy.
No, the degrees of freedom are defined in the problem. So what are you trying to optimize? That's what we're asking. So you have many ways to do the same thing. You choose the optimum. But what optimum? Optimum could be speed, could be accuracy, could be energy, probability of success, computation. That's the one I was looking for. Okay. So one thing that you can think of is like, I want to do the one that is easier for me to compute. Okay, maybe it doesn't take the less energy in terms of muscle activity, but it takes less energy for the brain, or it requires less neurons. Okay, it's energy, but it doesn't. It maybe when you write the number, it will be like it wouldn't be optimal in terms of ATP, okay, but it will still be some kind of energy. So computational complexity is extremely important aspect. And one thing that hints for that is that, and this is kind of a little bit of a kind of a paradox, although you have almost infinite number of ways to do a movement, usually your movement is very stereotypical. So if I ask you to, you know, to reach for something, you always do the same thing, okay? Almost the same thing, or very, very similar. And so much so that what you see here is kind of people who want to move a robotic arm, okay? And they face this extremely difficult problem of how do we make, this seems to be like, for someone who's never done that, this seems almost trivial, right? I want to move my hand from here to here. I have like three motors, what's the problem, right? If you'll try to kind of compute all the combinations of the things that you can do, you'll end up like, I don't know how to do that. And okay, I solved that, now I want to move my hand there. What I do now? It's not so, it's really difficult. Okay, so what people kind of try to do in order to solve that is actually just imitate the system. So what they do is just they kind of place like, LEDs or something on the person's hand, tell him to do that movement, right? And kind of then trace it and then kind of replicate this as a program that you tell the robot. Okay? And this is pretty efficient way to learn to do that, except that it's like it's not very general in some ways, right? You want to understand, you know, more basic things about this process. So basically, one of the questions that we're trying to solve is to understand how a motor command, which means like, you know, bring your hand from here to there, how is it processed through the system? What different parts of the brain are dealing with? Which parameters? How do they send it to other systems? What coordinate systems do they use? So coordinate system is extremely kind of important issue. Do you move the hand in terms of your body coordinate? Do you tell, you know, do you represent the hand in terms of where I am and what's the radius and distance of my arm for my body? Or do you use like, you know, Cartesian coordinates with X, Y, and Z? Some transformations, like when you write the equations of movement in some coordinate systems, they become much more complicated than in other coordinate systems. And in many ways, when you look at the in the brain, actually, sometimes you can see representation of one coordinate system or a different coordinate system. Okay. This is not that important. Okay, and obviously, on top of all that, there is motor learning. So, for example, I told you that like movements are stereotypical. So this is kind of a case. When do we spend with time? We have to stop. This is a case where this is one of the most studied system in neuroscience. You have a monkey. It has to move a handle in two dimensions, and it has like eight targets, and it needs to move the target to one of these directions. And what you see here are traces of the monkey as he learns to do the task. And you see that there are kind of stereotypical movements, okay? But they're kind of not very accurate. But, you know, with time, day after day, he becomes better and better. And eventually, he's becoming very stereotypical. Okay? So he's doing it very, very accurately. In the same way, and you see that some of the solutions are not like, for example, straight lines. So you can go from here to here like that, but he actually does that. Okay? And he always does that.
Sorry for the stupid and unrelated question. So what's the advantage of making this kind of treatment with a monkey?
Okay. So
Not with a human being.
Okay, you'll see it obviously. Okay, so first of all, it's true that a lot of this is done on humans. There's a whole area called motor psychophysics, and what they do, I might even kind of get a guest lecture on that. I'm not sure about that yet. But what they do is they use what they call a robot. It's not really a robot, but they use on this handle, they have motors. Okay, and then what you do is like you train the person to do this movement again and again, or this movement, and then suddenly you change in one of the some of the trial, you suddenly change the world. So like you try to do that, but the robot actually puts some force towards some direction. So you have to learn now to change the force you use with your muscle to reach the same target. Okay, and by doing so if you have like you have a mechanical model of your arm and of the muscles and the and skeleton, and you have a computational, you have an idea how do you actually compute that, by perturbing this movement in different ways, you can actually learn something about what the motor programs that the brain is using in order to do this movement. So a lot of that is done in this sense, and I'm not an expert in this field, but I know that they learned a lot about motor planning and motor systems this way. The advantage of monkeys is that you can record from the brain when they do that, and this is where it started. Okay, so people started with that in order to record from the brain, and they learned a lot of things about the brain that we'll show you before. We'll show you like maybe in the talk of Ifat, but this was the beginning. This task was the beginning of these of all these movies that you see today of brain-machine interface. This is where it comes from. Okay, people started with that, realized how the brain is doing that, and then use this knowledge. This is like obviously this is what you would tell donors, right? But in a way, okay. You take it with a lot of, reservations. But you understand how this happens in the brain, and then you use the signals of the brain to move a robotic arm to do the same movement that you would do. Very simplified. So usually what they did is like they started by, so the advantage of monkeys on mice. First of all, back then, no one has done, okay, so we have to take a break, but I'll tell you in one sentence. The biggest problem of the motor system in terms of research is that Ubel and Wiesel could do the experiments with anesthetized cats, right? You can't do any research about motor control with anesthetized animals. You have to have animals that are awake and behaving, okay? Back then, doing that on rodents was almost impossible. And even today, there's a big problem of doing research on motor systems in rodents because, first of all, they're not that sophisticated in terms of movement. Second, as I told you, there's a significant change in evolution in the motor system of rodents and primates. If you want to understand how our system works, you can learn some principles, but there is a major change. And the third is that if you have ever seen a mouse, what you can see is only the wrist. Okay, all the rest is like packed in a sack of skin and fat, and you actually cannot move, and you cannot trace the joints the way they move. So all that makes things very complicated, as well as the fact that they're small. Okay, so people done that in monkeys, and in this case they were training the monkeys to do the task, and once they reach this stage and the monkey knows how to do the task, then they implanted electrodes and started recording. Okay, and the advantage of this system is that it's complicated movement, but the monkey is sitting still. So the brain is in one position. You don't need to, kind of, it's not flying around. This is going to, I mean, my personal prediction is that the monkey research type of things like that now is going to have like a leap, because we're going into wireless system. So monkeys can go free, and you can still record from the brain, you know, even if they are in the cage. They don't even have to be in the lab. Okay, but we'll talk about it later. Okay, so let's take a break and continue afterwards. צריך הפסקה במשרד שלך. No, a lo corto. Okay, so who knows what a sarcoma is? Who knows what a sarcoma is? Oh my God. Okay, so I'm going to do it very, very fast, but I think you should, for yourself, you have to kind of complete it later. So basically, if you take a muscle and you cut it, you cut through a muscle. A muscle is made out of cells, which are called muscle fibers, and each muscle fiber. So this would be a muscle fiber. No. I will talk about that later. Okay. The rakshrir. Okay. So the muscle itself contains these tubes, which are called microfibrils. Okay. And these microfibrils are made out of sections that are called sarcomere. So this is like an enlargement of a sarcomere, and a sarcomere is this basic unit that is doing contractions in muscles. Okay, so the sarcomere itself, this is one section of this microfibril. If you look into it, okay, it contains many of these filaments, the actin filaments, okay, and the myosin filaments. Okay, and as you see, it has this organization when you have like two actin filaments, and then the myosin is kind of doing the bridging between them. Okay, and these myosin heads are interacting with the actin and doing these movements. Okay, and this is what makes a contraction. So basically, when these move, the actin filaments get close to each other. Okay, this is basically the contraction. Okay, this is how it is done, and none of these are actually changing they're not stretching, not the myosin or the actin. They're not the length of these are constant, but there is a relative movement of one to the other. You can see it here, right? This is basically what you see. So this would be the actin. And this is myosin, and the myosin kind of pull together the actin filament. So this unit is called the sarcomere, and this is the element that is producing the force in the muscle. Okay, really, really briefly, how this actually being done? You have this head of the myosin and the actin filament, and they kind of suppose they can interact, okay? But they don't interact unless there is calcium around. So when there is calcium around, it actually exposes these active heads of the actin, and then the myosin can actually bind to the actin. Once it binds, it does this movement, okay? So this backward movement, it flips back, okay? And this is what pulls the actin. But when this movement happens, you see here that the myosin is bound to ADP is bound to the myosin. The ADP is actually released, And then in order to make the myosin do the movement back and stretch again, you need ATP. So this is where the ATP comes. The ATP actually, when it comes, it breaks this bond with the actin. It makes this movement back, and then the myosin is actually in a position to bind to the next actin binding site. Okay, so then you can actually do that all the time, and it slides the actin over the myosin. Okay, so this is called the sliding filament theory. It's obviously in physiology you can understand that this is extremely important area, and it has been studied many years, and it's pretty well understood. Even at the single molecule level, so you can actually do imaging and measurements on really one piece of actin and one piece of myosin. So this is like, you know, two slides, but it's like you can read books about that. So I'm not going to get into it more than that. But if you want, you should actually find it for yourself. Okay, so now there is when you take a muscle, you take a muscle, it's made out of many muscle fibers, okay? And you can actually do things like measure the force that this muscle can produce as a function of, I'll go a few slides forward. Where is it? Okay. And then we'll go back to that. Okay, so when you take a muscle, you can actually hold it between, say, two things that hold it. I didn't actually... Sorry. This is a bit confusing, but okay. Notice that the muscle itself usually is connected on both sides with tendons, okay, with gidim. Okay, so they're holding it on the side. So you can actually take this part of the tendon and this part of the tendon, hold them, okay, and then activate the muscle with electrical stimulation. Okay. And then measure the force of the muscle. So this is an example of what happens if you kind of measure the force. So this is the force here, right? And these are the activation. So if you activate it like a very low frequency, what you get is a twitch. So you see kind of the muscle kind of vibrate, and it produces a small force that relaxes back. And then after it finished to relax, then you can give another one and another one. So this is called twitch. And it doesn't produce a lot of force. You see, it's pretty small. You just have a force. For example, you can just measure force, pulse per second. Okay. So if you increase the frequency, you see that then you start to get like EPSPs in a way, right? Temporal summation. So you have like force building up, okay? And you get like this kind of summation, and you reach a different level of force. If you activate even faster, you reach a even higher level, and at a very, very fast rate, you go to what's called fused tetanus. So it's like the largest force that this muscle can produce.
When you activate it electrically, basically what's happening is calcium being released?
Calcium will get into the muscle, and then it allows this movement. So this is exactly what I said, all the details, how calcium gets into the muscle, how it diffuses, how it's being regulated, all these things are extremely important.
Once the muscle gets failed, essentially?
What?
Once the muscle gets failed, then it's not failed? That's sort of enough time?
We'll talk about it. Yes, I mean, you can do that forever, of course. But this would be, you know, things that have to do with calcium accumulation, ATP regulation, you know, how much ATP you have in the muscle. Once you don't have ATP, even if you put calcium in, you can't actually do this movement. And
okay. If it's a conformational change, can it just stay in a different stage and just stay that way?
So for example, what happens in, you know, this is not so nice to talk about, but what happens in death when you don't have ATP is that everything is stuck in that position. So this is like the rigidity of the muscles that you get. I don't know. What? In?
When you get a cramping muscle.
I'm not sure. I think it has to do also with lactate and stuff like that. So one thing to know is that the tetanus force is usually way stronger than the normal force. So usually you would kind of you would work in this unfused tetanus, and you know that muscles never, usually in the body, never work in the maximal force, because then things would break. Actually, you have a lot of feedback system to prevent that, and this is some of the source. I don't know if you ever seen that, but the famous pictures of people who were under LSD. You know, taking LSD and were bound to beds, and they had like deformation of the bones because they were actually not feeling pain, and could actually you can actually break your bones or twist your bones just because you have much more force than you, the muscle can produce much more force than you want. So this was just to, but the point was here to tell you that this is like. It's like twitch is the minimal force that you produce by single pulse, and a tetanus is like the maximal force that you can produce on the muscle. So now we go back to this is what's called isometric force of a muscle. So you put a muscle, you don't let it change its length. Okay, and you measure how much force this muscle can produce at each length. Okay, and what you find out, what you find is that both for twitch force and tetanus force. So these are the dashed line here. Okay, these are the measurements. Okay, of the force. These are the measurements. Ignore solid line for a second. So plot here is the muscle length, and what you plot here is the tension, and you see that the maximal tension rise more or less at the beginning linearly with the length of the muscle. So the longest, if you pull the muscle, it will produce more force than if it's like short. Okay, until you reach a point when you kind of pull it more, then it produces less force. Okay. However, when you pull the muscle has also elastic elements. It has all these membranes and stuff. So when you pull it, the muscle at some point starts to produce some force because it's just like a spring. Okay, so it has some force. Okay, so if you subtract this is what we call the passive. Right? If you subtract this from that, you see that this reduction is even larger. Okay. And notice here that you can actually plot the same curve with different type of axis that correspond to the muscle length. One is, you know, this is pretty simple. This is the angle of an ankle, of a joint. Okay, so when you change the joint, the length of your muscle is changing. Okay, so the amount of force basically that your muscle can produce is different in this condition than in this condition, right? Or in this condition, because the length of the muscle is different.
The length is in the
micron. No, so this is the length.
This
is the length in centimeters. This is a change. This is measuring the same thing as a function of the angle, And what you do, what you show here, is when you stretch the muscle, you basically stretch the sarcomere, okay, as well, because they're inside the muscle. So when you stretch the sarcomere, this gives you like a different scale that you can actually measure. So even if you have like, this is basically, if you want, this is a canonical, axis in that sense, because all muscles have sarcomeres, okay, which are the same length. So this would be dependent on specific muscles that you measure. This is kind of independent of the specific muscles that you measure, because this is just kind of look at what the length of the sarcomere, right? So a longer muscle, you'll have to stretch more or less. Okay? And this scale gives you a hint why this happens, right? And the reason is that it depends on, if you want, on the it depends on on this relationship between this myosin and actin, because if the muscle is too short, you have like an overlap, and the myosin cannot actually, these heads of the myosin are not kind of efficient because they're working on the same actin filament that these are working on, right? So only these are efficient. If you are kind of here, then you kind of you can sometimes skip, and you cannot actually get the actin to start on. And this is kind of the optimum, where you have like all the actin, all the myosin heads interacting with the actin. So all the myosin interacting with the actin. Okay. Last thing about that is that this curve, if you work. Okay, so this is tetanus, right? So we said it's not really interesting. This is twitch, so it's kind of weak. But in this unfused tetanus, you would have something similar to that, and which will be somewhere here, and will be quite like these two, will be more or less linear to some extent. So if you think of one joint, okay, that has like two muscles, two antagonist muscles, the flexor and the extensor, at each position of the joint, you'll get different lengths of each one of these muscles, right? On one end, and then by activating each one of these muscles with a different activation, you can get different force length relationship, right? Just like we saw between twitch, unfused, and tetanus, you can actually change the slope of this curve of this force length relationship. So basically, the idea is that at the point when these two curves, you know, intersect here, you have an equilibrium point, right? They kind of cancel each other. And then the joint is like at a specific position. So the idea is that you can kind of now think of like moving the joint just by playing with these two activations of these two muscles. Right? So this is like a very simplistic way how you can actually control movement of the joint. And you can see that you have some degrees of freedom. You can actually achieve this location or this location with different activations, right? So this already tells you.
You have more solutions. It's not a
So now we're starting to talk about control.
Several muscles fibers, also sometimes several muscles. body, we talk about muscle. Okay, but in terms of control, what we actually care about is what are we controlling. Okay, so the idea here is that instead of talking about the muscle, we talk about what we can control. And so what we say is that a motor unit is one motor axon, or if you want, one motor neuron. And all the muscle fibers that are innervated by it. So basically, when I put a spike in this motor neuron, which muscle fibers are going to act? Is it a motor unit? So it's one, which is the axon, or the neuron, plus all the muscle fibers that are connected.
So one muscle fiber can be connected to two motor axons, or no?
No, we'll talk about that. This is what it looks like. So you have like you have a muscle, and inside the muscle you have muscle fibers, and here you have motor neurons. So this is if you remember, this is the spinal cord. We have the dorsal horn, remember from last year. This is the dorsal root ganglion, where the input from sensory input comes, like somatosensory input comes here into this dorsal horn. But in the ventral horn that we didn't mention, this is where all the motor neurons. Okay, so the ventral horn is like the area of the motor cord that is closer to the front of the body, inside the spinal cord. And we have two of them, one for the left and one for the right, each segment. So the segments are the same as we said before. The difference is that these dorsal root ganglion neurons are peripheral neurons, they belong to the peripheral system. They come from the neural crest, as Chaya told you, and they actually migrate out of the system. But the motor neurons are part of the spinal cord, which is part of the central nervous system. Now, interestingly enough, you'll see in a second, the axons of these are actually bundling together with the axons that come from the periphery, and they make one nerve. So a nerve is just a bundle of axons, and these are axons that they actually run together, but some of them are what we call efferent, they actually send command, and some of them are afferent, they are receiving input from the periphery. Okay? And they travel together even though some of them are peripheral neurons and some of them are central neurons. So this motor neuron is sending an axon, and this axon is making synapses with many muscle fibers. Okay? But each muscle fiber is innervated just by one motor neuron, one axon. And the process by which this happens is a very interesting process. And it's a kind of a competition. So at the beginning, early on, each muscle fiber would be connected by several motor neurons, and then some of these synapses will vanish, and some will become stable synapses. And eventually, this process. So if you think about these two motor neurons here, at the beginning they will innervate many muscle fibers, both of them will innervate them, and one of them will retract from some, and the other will retract from others, and eventually each one of them will have a group of muscle fibers that it controls, and no one else controls. And the other one will have a distinct other group of muscle fibers that it controls. And this process of competition is a very complex one. The person who actually is leading this area is called Jeff Lipman. If you haven't seen this picture of the rainbow, mm-hmm. Rainbow? So he actually designed that because he was like the one that was tracing different axons and wanted to see which one is doing which. So he was.
By what age does each single muscle fiber have just one axon?
I don't know, actually. Somewhere early on in why you might have one multiple limitation. Okay, so this is an example of a mapping of a, you know, this is a muscle, okay? And what you see here is like different sections through the muscle. And you see here the like the amount of fibers that are innervated by the same motor neuron. Okay, the way they did it is a bit kind of strange. I don't have a picture. What they did is kind of they recorded intracellularly from one motor neuron and activated it like a lot of time. And basically depleted the ATP from the muscle fibers that were kind of all the time were activated. And then they did a staining for that, so that we could actually see the muscle fibers that don't contain ATP or contain much less ATP than the others, and could actually count them. And what you see here is that they're like muscle fibers that are innervated, there's an area where most of them are, but there are others along the fiber, and in total, you can get thousands of muscle fibers innervated by the same motor neuron. Okay? And there's a lot of overlap, so you can see like very neighboring muscle fibers that are innervated by different. So this is like one motor neuron innervating muscle fibers, but around this fiber there are other fibers that are innervated by a different system.
This is something that once it's set, it doesn't change, right?
No, it doesn't change, but for example, if you have like for example, a motor neuron that binds, and then you have like muscle fibers that are not innervated. So, for example, if you kill this motor neuron, then this muscle fiber will start looking for different axons, and these axons can actually sprout and make new fibers, even in the dark. Okay, so this is part of the regeneration that is possible. Sometimes happens. So you know that if you different from the central nervous system, when you have like a lesion, axon cannot actually find a way back, usually because they have all kinds of microglia and other neurons that eat this. Here, so we didn't mention that, but remember that Chaya told you that what myelinates these neurons is Schwann cells. And all these neurons, all these motor neurons are myelinated. Okay? So the Schwann cells actually can keep the track, and they can actually keep the same place without actually. And then they can actually let neurons regrow, the axon regrow through the same track and finally start it. But sometimes, in accidents and stuff like that, this is actually being done. And sometimes manage to keep these things. It's extremely difficult and it doesn't always, but there is a possibility for regeneration. And obviously, lower animals.
So, two quick questions. First, so in the spinal cord, you have chosen the layer, is there some kind of like homunculus? Is there some organic reason in the organization, or everything is just mixed up?
First of all, of course, there is an organization that is very similar to the organization of the somatosensory area. Obviously, you know, at each segment, you control an area that are like
within that segment, so within a layer.
Within one segment?
Yeah.
It's like kind of somatotopy.
The center motor neurons will be connected to the center of the fibers or whatever, and
not that I know. It's possible that there is, I don't know, like a very detailed somatotopic map.
kind of phenomena where a master is switching unwillingly, and used to be said that this is kind of a neurological phenomenon. You know what I mean? When the finger is...
In the East tremor, we talk about this.
Okay.
There's a different type of tremor. Some of them are exposed, but you have
that's the name?
Tremor is like oscillation of the muscle.
And that's the movement that is not...
But you have like different ones. So you have different... You have like what you call physiological tremor, which is like tremors, and then you have tremors that results from like pulses in the knee that are bigger and kind of different frequency. So
that's the
difference.
You must have said to me what on the cold of the...
I'm not sure. You mean that like when you do physiotherapy after an injury?
Yes.
So I don't know if it's and you regain function. That's the kind of thing.
I think because you're building to the concentration different way, you need them.
So the different. Okay, so the. I don't think I can give a definite answer. What I can give you, and I don't know as well, but what I can tell you is like two different things. One is that we have many degrees of freedom, and that's the key thing. I don't know if you ever, any of you saw like this, there was a Katava. 2 weeks ago, on the Paralympic swimmer, Israel world champion Paralympic swimmer, the woman, she I don't remember exactly how, but due to an accident, she lost control of her limbs. And she was a swimmer, and she won medals in like 3 Paralympics. And recently she went to a physiotherapy, and even though she still doesn't have control on her muscles, central control of the muscle of her limb, she said she's able to walk with, she's able to stand, and she's able to walk with, and it's kind of almost impossible to understand how that happens. But basically what they did is like they managed to teach her to gain, or to change basically other muscles are doing the work for her. It's very strange, it's like she's standing, if you push her, she'll fall. But she's able to maintain posture even though she doesn't control the muscle of her. So it's very, very strange, but I think that's what you can expect from physiotherapy. So it's like you can expect the brain to learn to operate other muscles in order to compensate for the ones that you cannot use. And there's also it's also important to mention, so I told you, if you kill this one, you'll have these ones innervated by other neurons. But if you cut those two, or if you cut all the input to a muscle, then you get what used to call atrophy. So the muscles start to degrade and they kind of become much weaker. Lose muscle. Another interesting issue is that, you know, when you train, after you haven't trained a lot for a long time, you very quickly feel that you have more power. And a lot of that is not because that anything is changing in these muscles, but things happen in this neuromuscular junction. So like probability of release becoming larger. So your activation of the muscles become more effective rather than muscle intensity. Thank you. Okay, so again, you have like you have huge differences in size of motor units. For example, in the leg, you can get to thousands of muscle fibers per axon, but in the eye, you have sometimes less than 100 muscle fibers per axon. The eye, by the way, is one of the other systems that doesn't have any skeleton, right? So it's all muscles against muscles. You want it extremely accurate movement, and obviously when you control less muscle fibers, your movement becomes more accurate. We talked about that. There are three types of motor units. Usually, you can actually divide it into more. And this is related to how much force they do, or how fast they react, and how do they do what the type of adaptation they have with time. Again, similar to things that we've seen in the somatic sensory system, but in the other direction. So this is what happens when you take a slow muscle, you activate it, it doesn't produce almost any force, it's like 2 grams, per twitch, and if you activate it many times, you can summate it, okay, but it still doesn't reach a lot of force. On the other hand, if you do that, and then stop, and then do it again, and then stop, and do it again, and do it for minutes, you get always the same force, so it doesn't actually get then on the other extreme, you have a motor unit that when you activate them, you get a lot of force, like 50 grams per twitch, and then you can actually reach a larger force. But if you do it many times, very, very fast, you could get fatigue and you won't be able to get any activity out of it. And then there are things in between. And this has to do with the metabolism of the muscle fibers. And the, we're not going to go into that. But there is like the axons of the motor unit are all myelinated, but they don't have the same velocity or conduction velocity, and they kind of have this rule. That fast fatigue motor unit has faster conduction velocity than fatigue resistant and faster than slow unit. Okay, so if you activate this one, you get a lot of force and fast. If you activate this one, it will take time and you get less. And this kind of leads us to the last part of this. Which is recruitment. Okay, so it turns out that if you take a muscle and you pull it and you apply more and more force and you measure from the muscle unit that innervates this muscle, what you see is that first this is the extracellular coding from the nerve that innervates this muscle. What you see is that at the beginning you see spikes coming out from one unit. And then as the force that you start to activate become larger, you start to recruit another one. You see? So this is when the other one starts to be activated. Okay, and now what you can do is actually take the force and do what we call spike-triggered averaging. We take every time every spike we have, we kind of measure the change in force. And we average that. And then you see that unit 1 is actually generating a pretty small force compared to unit 2 that actually innervates exerts more force per spike, okay, and faster. So this is like an evidence, this is not an experiment, it's just kind of an illustration, but this is something that the very basic principle that many people have established. Still, there are kind of debates around it, but the idea is that you have a principle in recruitment of call the size principle. But first you recruit the small unit, and then you kind of, as you need more force, you recruit the large unit. Okay, so for example here, when you walk, you recruit units that are, so here you see the force that the units are producing. Okay, so you recruit units that are not kind of generating a lot of force, and as you start like running or jumping, you start to generate, you recruit larger units, and then you have a jump in the force that, that you make, because you know you recruit a bigger unit. Now this is kind of the idea behind it is, I find it personally, I find it confusing, but the idea is that you don't generate force until you need it, in a way. Okay, but when you think about, like, sometimes when you do a movement, so the thing is that when you recruit this one, you cannot be very accurate, or very strong. Every small difference in the activation of the movement units will kind of generate a big change in force. Okay, so it's a question, and this is why I'm personally a bit confused about it, how actually relatively is it to real world, in the sense that when you want to do something which needs force, let's put it this way. So usually when you do a movement that is requires a lot of force, you're not very accurate, you know. So in some sense, there's no much sense in actually recruiting first the small units, which are the ones that give you like a small precision. So it would make sense that if you want to apply more force, a lot of force, you recruit a strong one. The one you want delicate, you recruit a small one. Okay, but it doesn't work like that. That's the empirical observation. You start with a small one, then you go to the big one, which is kind of confusing. There are some considerations about that in terms of, like, if you think about your precision in terms of the log of the force that you apply. So it cannot be more precise than the log of the movement of the force that you want to make. We can talk about it, you know, later if you want. It's a bit kind of tricky to convey into. But I just want to
when do we think this graph that this is about small and big units? It looks like just more and more units and nothing is said about this.
No, this is one unit that is recruited from here to here. Right? So you recruit like more. So at the beginning you recruit the small ones. It's like what you've seen here. At the beginning you recruit the small ones, and then when you need more force you recruit bigger ones. And these bigger ones are kind of generating much more force. In order of magnitude more. That's the idea.
So when you say bigger ones, you mean that more.
A bigger motor unit means that the motor unit, a motor neuron that controls more muscle fiber. But it also goes together with this fast fatigue versus slow. Okay, so you can see here, you start with a slow, then you take this fatigue resistance, and then at the end you recruit the fast fatigue, which apply a lot of force, but they cannot actually stay for long. They cannot jump like for. Okay, so how does it work? So this is like an idea, which I'm not sure is actually holds any water, but in the textbook it's like very popular. So the idea is that I told you that like the bigger motor unit, the one that has more muscle fibers, the motor neurons are bigger, the axon is bigger, everything is bigger. So the idea is that you have like interneurons that recruit them. Okay, and this one is kind of at the beginning, it makes an EPSP, and because the input resistance of this neuron is larger because it's smaller, then this EPSP can get it to threshold, but here it will be sub-threshold. And only when you increase the frequency of this, then you'll get to threshold of this one, and then you'll recruit the big one. that's the idea. I'm not sure. I mean, that if you really look into that, there are so many like inhibitories and neurons and other things that are going on. I'm not convinced that this is the most one. Last thing is that this is actually the size principle, for example, is being studied many times in humans. You can actually put electrodes through the skin into the nerve and actually measure the recruitment. So you ask people to apply more and more force, you can actually distinguish the different units. So you see these are different spikes from different axons, so you can see which one is like recruited when. And this is actually has some also some diagnostic value, so you can actually use that with people that have some problems in conduction of, you know, cases, clinical cases where the problem is actually in conduction of spike into the muscle, and this is actually, this could be recorded in humans, for example, if you have inflammation, something that pushes on the nerve, you can measure this. Okay, so let's finish today here.
Yes, sir. Yeah.